Good evening. I regret to inform you that we've lost the identity of tonight's speaker. However, I'm pleased to inform you that we're on the track to recover that missing information. Wendy Heldman, who has managed this lecture series for several years, has informed me that the speaker's name and the name of his firm have disappeared from her hard drive, but fortunately, not without a trace. So far, our forensic experts have been able to reconstitute a sequence of four letters, a W, an O, an L, and an F. The remaining data is apparently irretrievable. What can we surmise from those four letters? Wendy suggested they might be an acronym for a company's name, or an architect's name, or perhaps a nom de plume, but we couldn't be sure. Therefore, we concluded that W, O, L, and F research was the only means available to identify SIARC's surreptitious lecturer for this evening. A W, an O, an L, and an F. What might those letters signify? I can assure you we have exhaustively examined all conceivable possibilities, and I'm now prepared to give you a synopsis of our conclusions. Could W, O, L, and F point to the infamous Wolfman, a split personality, half man, half wolf, or possibly the Steppenwolf, the ubiquitous street corner philosopher, or perhaps Beowulf, a heroic monster slayer? Or how about Peter and the Wolf? It's all a fairy tale. Or might it be Wolfman Jack, the infamous LA disc jockey? Maybe the wolf in sheep's clothing, the devil masquerading as a saint. Perhaps the big bad wolf, the quintessential appetite for innocence. Wait a minute. Gradually, details of the speaker's identity have begun to emerge. The surreptitious lecturer is surreptitious no longer. And I'm now prepared to reveal the truth. In fact, every wolf pro forma is correct. Please welcome the schizophrenic street corner philosopher, monster slayer, fairy tale teller, music man, devil in disguise, innocence, demolition man, Wolf Prix, to SIARC.
It's good to be back. I have to say, I love LA and I really love SIARC. Especially when I see the last thesis, it reminded me that I'm in an art school, not in an architectural school, because it's going more to in the direction of painting than in the direction of architecture. Doesn't matter. This is why I like this school so much. It was not so long ago when the four musketeers of LA came to Vienna and giving a lecture there, perfect lectures. Rotto was there, Tom was there, of course, Greg, and Eric Owen Moss. They did great lectures. Very special lecture was the lecture of Eric Owen Moss. He did a lecture 1.5 hour long, not showing one architectural project. He was talking about. What was he talking about? I think I can summarize his lecture in a question and answer. The question is, Eric, what is architecture? And his answer is, yes. So what's the difference? The answer is no. When I was in Rome a couple of months ago, I was in the Sixtine Chapel, and I saw this painting, and I said, something is wrong with this painting. How would we paint this painting nowadays? Maybe like this. Can we replace the old guy by a touch phone? So what's the difference? What's the difference between this kind of architecture I saw in the New York Times, I think 2 months ago, and between, what's the difference between these two images or these two architectural strategies? I can make it short and say, one shows, and this is the house from 1959, it shows the mentality of bigger than life, and now we are in the concept of being smaller than life. How can we overcome this mentality of being smaller than life? I know that the future of our profession doesn't look good. The future, of course, is very, very vague. And I think what we have to do now is to develop strategies to overcome this vague future, to overcome this pessimistic attitude. 5 years ago, when I was talking to my students, I said, I really don't envy you, because your time is a very difficult time. A lot of architects are doing a lot of projects which look very alike, because they're using the same program, they're using the same ideas, and publishing all over the world. Now I would say, okay, now it's time to rethink the whole attitude of using machines and using architectural surfaces. Now it's time to think in a more, let's say, society way. Why? Our society, as we know, is a very complex society, and complex societies produce complex problems. Complex problems are demanding for complex solutions. And complex solutions, you have to know, they are not they are not easy, they are not simple. They have the advantage to be very new. The disadvantage is that they are not perfect. That means that complex solutions are never perfect, but they are new. How can we overcome this pessimistic attitude for the future? I think we have to extend the meter by 5 centimeters. Why? If you extend the meter by 5 centimeters, the volume will increase 15%. That means if you want to build it, and you take into account that the inflation is 5% per year, you have the building built 3 years earlier. It's a complex solution. To get along with this, you have to follow Bob Dylan, and this, especially these two sentences: don't follow leaders, watch the parking meters, or you don't need a weatherman to know which way the wind blows. But, and this is one quote I always use when I'm talking about education, the quote of Saint-Exupéry, which tells you that if you are teaching, don't teach the students to use the tools, but rather awake the desire for architecture. To redefine private and public space, I think if you go with the new medias and say there is no need to have a public space anymore because it's in the media. Imagine these are airplanes moving around the world, and if every airplane has 300 people talking to the other 300 people in the other airplane, the whole world is a public space. But it's not a real public space, it's only a media space. And I think this is a very old theory, and I think Rainer Benham said it long time ago that the public space in LA is not existing, except you say that the car is a public space and the telephone in the car makes it public. But what is a real public space? Imagine if we wouldn't, or the Arabian, the Egypt guys wouldn't have an address where they can congregate. So where would have been the point of departure of the revolution? A public space is defined by public and by private. Public and private space is defined by both things. Is this a public, are these tanks public? And this guy, is this guy private? Or what is private here and public there? It's always police on one hand or military on the other hand, and it always has a little sexual connotation. So if we want to have a new redesigned public space, we should use other methods than just architectural one in order to define an address. We need an address, we need time, and we need a home. Otherwise, how does it feel? If we are timeless, placeless, and homeless, maybe we get clueless. There are two, I would like to divide two behaviors of an architect, or better, an architect who behaves like a fish in an aquarium, or the other architect is dancing in front of the client. The architect who wants to communicate with his client, he needs to break the glass, and then he will, of course, die. The notation of this is done by the computer like that. But I have to say, I prefer the other way around. This is how the other way around looks like. Architect waiting for his client. Concentrating. Client is coming. This is the model. Now, clients open the door. So, and you have to know, and this is a very bad experience I did in the last couple of years. We have to deal a lot of with mediocrity, and I have to tell you